Glazing 101. Well, it's not really 101. Okay, so in this classroom, this is teaching you how to use this glaze area and some of the basic glaze moves you're gonna need. Some of you, you've already seen it. You've got this. You're gonna show your leadership by doing this excellently. The rest of y'all are gonna learn this today. You're gonna ask the people before you who've done this before how to do this if it's not clear. So we're gonna start with these buckets of stuff. So what is glaze? Glaze is a coating. It is a ceramic coating that is not paint. Some people will use the word paint in the ceramics room. This is definitely not paint. Paint has minerals in it. This is minerals that are applied as a coating, and then when heat is applied to this piece, then it chemically changes to form this mineral surface. So it's sort of a glassy coating. It's in these buckets is a suspension, not a solution, of minerals that will become the coating on your piece. So what's in here, because it's a chemical reaction, doesn't look like what it's going to look like. Like this one here is going to be that one there. All right, this one here, this red one, actually, my hands are a little messy. Does not look red. Are you with me? It looks kind of grayish, whitish. All right? So, to use these buckets of minerals, because they are, they're sort of suspended in water, basically they sink down to the bottom over time with gravity, so you need to coax them back up so that they will provide a nice coating on your piece. So if I was gonna use this one, which I really like to use a lot, I'm gonna get this tool out here. I'm gonna stick that in there. I'm gonna push this button. Back dirty. Alright, kind of rinse it off. And I'm not going to hang it on the trigger either. That's not very good. Hang it on the handle right there. Are you with me? Okay, cool. Alright, so I have a whole bunch of colors here. There is a code board here. So these are the samples of these. This year we're going to do some overlap, so I'm going to teach you overlapping glazes. Overlapping is going to be a wild, crazy guess for you today. If you overlap and get an extra color where the overlap is, but for today you're going to at least know what the basic colors are that you're overlapping. And you can tell here, like this one, Byron's Oxblood, it's usually written somewhere kind of big on the bucket. Do you see it? Byron's Oxblood. I like to call it Spartan Red as well. Let's see, we have this beautiful purple, BK purple. It doesn't really look purple.
No, that's chung blue.
Okay. Ah, I put it out here. All right. So, does this look purple?
No.
Okay. Then what should I do?
Mix it.
Yeah, I should stir it. That's all watery on top. I can just do it like this, especially when it's that low. It's easy to mix. Also, it won't stain my arm as much as that one will. All right. Okay. So as you see right here, we have glaze tongs. Okay. We'll be dipping in these glazes with that. I forgot a step. All right. So here we have three waxing stations. The problem becomes when you glaze this stuff, if you get glaze on the bottom, then it sticks to the kiln furniture, to the kiln shelf. So you want to try to avoid that. So to keep your bottom clean, you are going to need to wax the bottom of your plate or whatever it is. So here's how you're gonna do this. So there's three stations. The wax is in this right here. There is a reason for that. Can anybody guess?
So it doesn't get on the table.
Yes, so it doesn't spill, because these brushes tend to be long handled and they tip it over. So you won't get wax like down on your shoes. Leave it in that thing. All right, so here's one. So I've put this on this. I'm going to spin it. And I have a goal of waxing the entire bottom. That's going to be sitting on the shelf plus a quarter inch, because gravity will tug on this glaze coating a little bit and bring it down. Are you with me? All right, so you're going to do that. It's also a great idea when you dip the brush in, it's fully charged, full of this wax stuff, this water-soluble wax. You are going to dab it off. Hello, stage. All right. So am I painting like this? No. I could do that later if I was going to do a design, but I'm not doing that right now. All right. So this is done. All right, it's ready to go. Now I just stirred this guy so I can take my tongs and just dunk it. This is the most basic way to apply ceramic coating. I just stirred it, dunk it in, out. All right, so there you go. So how good a job did that wax do?
Most of it.
It's okay. Yeah. It's okay. It's 2/3.
Yeah.
So what you gotta do, the wax will do some of it. But you actually do have to wipe your own bottom after this. Okay? So wipe it. Alright. There you go. So this then is ready to go outdoors to our high fire stoneware 2,400 degree kiln, which is out there. There's a picnic table out there, and you're going to set this on the picnic table. Are you with me? Okay. Now, that's the basic way. Are you ready for something a little more creative?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Excellent. Okay. So these glazes do change when you layer them. All right, so let's say I want to do an interesting layering on this. What should I do? Should I just start dipping?
No.
What should I do?
Look at the colors.
Okay, I want Byron's Oxblood to dip this into. Am I ready?
No. Do you already stir it?
What?
Do you stir it?
I need to stir it, thank you. Yes. All right, so I can stir it with the drill, I can stir it with my hand. So I'm stirring. A lot of people, and I see this every class. I've already had three classes today, and in three classes, people looked at a glaze and made the assumption someone had just stirred it. Don't make that assumption, Jacob. Just you stir it yourself. Okay. This already has a design on it, so if I add a design, it needs to emphasize the design I already have. I am going to dip a corner of this, one side, and then maybe the other, emphasizing this part. All right, I'm going to hang it like this to let it drip. The water seems like it's drying. It's not really drying. The water is wicking into the pot, to the pores of the pot. All right. Should I add any more? Is that good enough? Like a little crown for that heart?
Yeah.
Somebody needs to put on there?
I think it's good.
It's good enough.
Yeah,
all right.
Beautiful.
So let me show you some other techniques. All right. So some of you might have this. Oh, yeah. I saw that you all were sanding your pottery. That's a great idea. We have sanders for before it's fired and for sanders for after it's fired. Before it's fired, you can use the cheese grater. Can you hand me the cheese grater tool? thank you. If you use this on bisqueware, then you're basically ruining this. Okay? So don't use this. All right. So we'll put that back. Now, after this has turned to stone, you can tell because it's ringing a little bit. After it's been fired, you take this tool, and only if you have a like a little sharp thing, a little burr, then you can get that off. Or usually where you've signed your name, sometimes it's rough there. All right, but you don't have to sand it a lot. If you were gonna refine your piece, refine it before it's fired, not now. All right, so here I go. Gonna do this. Why am I starting out here down this pile of gravity? Because I have to do it a fourth of an inch, yeah. If I go just do this middle part here, the glaze, it's just gonna stick, yeah. All right, so are you ready?
Yes.
All right, so I happen to think Chun and this purple look good together. All right, I'm stirring with my hands, because that's how I am, that's how I roll. All right, so that's Chun. All right, this is the overlapping dip. All right, so I've got one. I'm holding it upside down because the drips that, you want to learn to control your drips and how it is part of the pot. So just give it a little time to continue dripping so it won't make like a messy drip. All right, so I have this side that has appeared to dry a little bit. And then actually Rhodes 32 is a really nice glaze. So this is kind of a matte white. I'm going to try to dip it interestingly around here. So I will have a slight overlap of a third color. So I'm going to have kind of a beautiful beigey, satiny white, an overlap like shaped like the moon, and then purplish blue on this side. Okay? So that's another thing. I want to teach you pouring. Okay. So let's see. All right, I'll just do two at once. So here comes two lessons in one. Are you ready?
Yes.
I'm holding my hand here. I could use tongs, but right now I want human expression. I want to signal to the viewer that this is handmade. It's actually been done since time immemorial. Like I got down this little moonshine jug. You can see fingerprints here as part of the decoration. So basically that tells a story of, I wonder what glaze that guy dipped in. Hey, that guy had a big enough hand to fit on the bottom. My hand doesn't quite fit there. So somebody with larger hands than me. Anyway, so watch. Okay, so I'm deliberately leaving a fingerprint there. Deliberately doing that. And I'm gonna get extra dark striping because this is my glaze. Where it's thick, it's gonna be black. Where it's thin, it's gonna be brown. All right, so now that little handprint is my sort of abstract decoration. And I could just leave it. But I'm gonna do a different lesson. This may or may not be, it may not turn out well, but it's fine. I'm just gonna give it a try. Let's see, I need something. Here we go. Well, I'm not gonna use that one. I'm gonna use this one. So I'm gonna get a cup from here. All right, are you ready? There we go. Okay. So now I'm going to have this weird handprint pattern, green in here because this is a green glaze, so green where my hand was, and then overlap section, and then blackish brownish. Okay. So do you all feel ready to do some glaze experiments?
Yes.
Yeah.
All right. What is the last thing I need to do right now before?
My
where do I carry this when I'm done?
To the table.
Out to the table. Yeah. Okay. Go.